What is up, guys? Rick Kakis here. Thank you so much for stopping by, and today we have the complete Deepstone Crypt Raid Guide for Dummies, showcasing every single mechanic of every single encounter, as well as a ton of tips and even loadout suggestions to help absolutely anyone beat this brand new Beyond Light raid. And so, let's get started. But just before we do, as you can imagine, these raid guides take a ton of work, as well as the fact that we had to beat an extra raid boss called Mr. Anteater, who reared his ugly head quite a few times during our run. So please, if you enjoy this video, if you find it informative, help it out by simply rating and especially sharing it. Really, really does help. All right, let's start out here with the very start of this raid. Now, you're actually going to load in kind of in the Eventide Ruins. From here, simply head forward and there's going to be a bunch of enemies in front of you. When you take those enemies down, you'll see a doorway has opened. Jump down there and then you can actually whip out your Sparrow, and that is going to be key. Get a good Sparrow, get a fast Sparrow, because you will need it for this encounter. Very soon you're going to find this bubble, and in this bubble are a bunch of pikes. It should be noted that the pikes are in no way required for this encounter. I think they're related to a Triumph, and in fact I would recommend against them. Your Sparrow is much faster. In any event, when you exit this bubble, you're very soon going to notice a debuff appear on the left corner of your screen, Frostbite. Now when this gets to times 10, you will die. So your goal is to get from that one safety bubble to the next by transversing this area. And this area is a little bit hard to transverse because it's covered in a pretty severe blizzard. And it should be noted that dying really doesn't matter too much. You're simply going to respawn in the last bubble. So just send everyone out as a bunch of feelers, essentially. Go as fast as you can with your Sparrow and try to spot that next bubble to really determine your path. And then just respawn and go the route you actually need to know how to go. Now, I am going to be showing the proper route within the background gameplay, but just keep that in mind. It should also be noted that you can actually use transporters within these bubbles to teleport to the previous bubble if you need to do so. Now, at some of these bubbles, there are going to be a decent amount of adds that push you. So while everyone is kind of arriving to that bubble on their Sparrows, take a little bit of extra time to kill those adds before moving on. But once you've gone from bubble to bubble to bubble to bubble, eventually you're going to get to one where a bunch of enemies are going to spawn, specifically a Brig will spawn there. Take those guys down, and then it's going to actually open a door right next to this bubble. You can head in there. Congratulations, you've finished with this encounter. On to the next one. All right, now we have your first real challenge with the Crypt Security encounter. So, as you'll notice, the arena is split into two halves. There's a light side, and then there's a dark side. And there's actually a whole area underneath that you can go to before you've started this encounter. So maybe take a little bit of time and explore this area, because you will need to know the layout of this arena. But then, when you are going to start the encounter, make sure you have part of your team on that light side and another part of your team on that dark side. You don't want to be all on one side because the doors will shut when the encounter starts. Now, to start the encounter, what you're going to do is go to this object, and as you can see, you can pick up a buff. And that buff is the Operator buff. Now, this is one of two extremely important buffs within this encounter, and it's introducing you to a raid mechanic that is definitely going to come up in future encounters. Now, the teammate that has the Operator buff can actually give it away. You can simply go back to these terminals, interact with it again, and then you will plant that buff in that terminal. And then any other teammate, except for you, can go to a terminal and pick up this buff. So you can transfer it from the light side to the dark side by using the terminals if you don't have any doors open. Keep that in mind. However, during this encounter, servitors are going to spawn. You'll see this text, and therefore you won't be able to utilize those terminals as long as that servitor is alive. However, after you start the encounter, you've grabbed the Operator buff, enemies are going to spawn, and eventually a special enemy is going to spawn. This one has a symbol above his head, a yellow symbol. When you kill that enemy, it's going to drop this yellow symbol on the ground. A teammate not the one with the operator buff, a different one, is going to have to go and grab this buff by interacting with that dropped object. Then they're going to have the other buff within this encounter, Scanner. So one guy on your team is going to be the operator and the other guy is going to be the scanner. These buffs do not run out, and again, how you transfer them is by utilizing the terminals. Alright, so what do you do now? Well, the operator can operate things. Something interesting to know is that the operator can go to the top part of the map, shoot the glowing red little data pads, which will open up the doors. So that's another way to get people from the light side to the dark side or vice versa. Now, the scanner is actually going to be looking for what the operator should shoot. Specifically, the operator will have to go into that top room and then shoot the middle doorway in there, and as you can see, gain access to the lower area. Only one person, the operator, can go down there at a time. Now, when the operator is down there, actually all of the data pads are glowing red. So it's actually up to the scanner from up above to tell the operator which data pads to shoot. And how to do that is the scanner, as you can see, will be able to look down through these windows essentially within the floor and see certain data pads glowing yellow. The other ones don't have any sort of glow. And there's always going to be four data pads, two glowing yellow on the light side and two glowing yellow on the dark side. So the person with scanner is gonna, let's say, start at the light side, find the two, point it out to the operator, and then the operator is going to open up that top door, send that guy through, and then the operator can go down to the bottom floor and shoot the two that was pointed out, whereas the scanner now can find and point out the two from the other side. Now, if you're having trouble with that, there's nothing preventing you from knowing where all four are and then having the operator go down, but that way is a little bit more time efficient. If the operator shoots the wrong panel when they're down there, it's going to initiate like a fire throughout the room and kill the operator. Okay, so once the operator has shot all four of the correct data panels, what next? Well, up top, you're going to notice the massive tubes open up in the center of the arena, and then you can start damaging them. But if you do, they'll start to glow red and you'll cause a wipe. And that's because you're probably, unless you've just guessed correctly, shooting the wrong one. There's six in total, three on the dark side and three on the light side. And what you have to do is get a scanner to see which one to shoot. To do that, the scanner is going to need to be, as you can see, down below, shouting out which little part is glowing and then telling the teammates up above, okay, it's leftmost on the dark side, or it's light side middle, right? And then your team is going from side to side and shooting the correct tube. How you get scanner down there is that once your operator has shot those correct panels and started the damage phase, they run to the terminal that's down there and they put their operator up, someone collects it, and then whoever is scanner puts their scanner down, and then the operator at the bottom, or the previous operator at the bottom, collects the scanner. Now you've got a scanner down there, and like right in front of them is the signs for how to shoot the correct tubes. And again, your teammates upstairs just listen to what that guy calls out and shoot the tubes, and it actually doesn't take a lot of damage to kill all six. Now, as for damage, something like Xenophage is fantastic. A good sniper rifle is great. But remember, you can be pretty close. So a good shotgun like the First In Last Out with Vorpal Weapon, that's going to be fantastic as well. And speaking of well, I guess, use a well. A well and a bubble are great for increasing your damage output. You may want to have some people with the Falling Guillotine Sword equipped, because there are going to be some powerful champions with Void Shields, and that just crushes through them. Additionally, you will have a few Overload champions, so I would highly recommend putting on the Overload Grenades from your seasonal artifact. Or if you don't have those, make sure to use an Overload mod, Overload Rounds, for an auto rifle, for example. Okay, but continuing on from there, we have the next encounter against Atrax 1 Fallen Exo. And this one's a doozy. Like, this is going to be, in my opinion, the hardest encounter of this raid. So, What do you do here? Well, it's pretty darn complicated. The first starting arena is only one half. There's actually a totally separate upper arena that you can get to if you, as you can see, utilize these dropships. It will shoot you into space, and then you're on the upper part of the arena. Now, in both of these arenas, you're going to see a lot of the boss. He is absolutely everywhere. He's cloned himself, and it's your job to get rid of these clones. So, how do you do so? Well, just like last time, you will have to utilize someone with Operator as a mod and someone with Scanner. So, the encounter starts and you want to split your team up 3 to the top, 3 to the bottom. If you want to be really optimal, technically the first DPS phase is at the top always, so you could send 4 up to the top for maximum DPS, but that's a little bit much, to be honest. Remember that when talking about the drop pods, the Operator can actually shoot the data pads near the drop pods and it will activate them. So the Operator can call up drop pods from the bottom to the top if people need to take them down. So just keep that in mind. In any event, once you've split your team up between the top and the bottom, then you're going to need to slay out on adds because you're going to have to kill all of the adds in that arena, especially kill the yellow bar shanks in order to spawn servitors. Now the servitors are usually going to spawn at one area and then move to the other. So they'll spawn at the bottom first, and once all the servitors are dead at the bottom, then they'll start spawning on the top and sometimes vice versa. But as servitors are spawning, then you're also going to see those important adds that have the buffs spawn as well. So always on the bottom area, you're going to, as the servitors are alive, see a guy with the Operator buff. Make sure someone at bottom kills that guy and grabs and holds onto that Operator buff, the red one. Then at the top, you're always going to have an add with the Scanner buff spawn again when the servitors are up. Same thing, make sure someone grabs a hold of that buff. At this point, once all the servitors at the bottom and all the servitors at the top are dead, all of the bosses at the top area are going to start to do a wipe mechanic, and they'll all start doing it at the same time. The person with the Scanner buff, as you can see one of those bosses glowing yellow. Then he needs to call out to everyone else on your team to get to that guy as quickly as possible, and you need to damage that guy as much as possible to prevent the wipe, mainly, but also to actually damage the boss. That's right, doing that, just preventing the wipe mechanic, is the actual way you beat this boss, is the way you lower the health. So, very importantly, this is a massive tip here. Don't just do damage until you cancel the wipe phase. You'll see us all the time in the background gameplay utilizing as many teammates as we have in the area with a bunch of swords. We got Falling Guillotines with Whirlwind's Blade to get more damage, even Lucent Blade as a mod. That's a great one as well. And what we're doing is we're kind of counting down, all right, 3, 2, 1, and then everyone does damage because you can see the wipe phase is canceled. The boss stops, but as that boss is kind of dying, you're still able to inflict damage just before he goes away. And that seems to really affect how much damage the health bar takes. So essentially what I'm saying is when you stop these wipe mechanics, overkill those guys. Go above and beyond when it comes to dealing damage quickly. And swords are by far the best strategy we found. Okay, so you've stopped the wipe mechanic on the top. Now, what's going to happen is the bosses at the bottom are going to do that same wipe mechanic. So as soon as you kill that first boss on the top, the person with Scanner needs to transfer that down to the people at the bottom. Someone at the bottom needs to grab it from the transfer station and then use it to find which boss on the bottom is doing the wipe mechanic, is glowing yellow, and do the exact same thing. Like call out to everyone, whoever's down there goes there, spins to wins with the sword, and gets that damage. Now, just before that happens, or just after that happens, remember that at some point you are going to have to transfer the red Operator buff up to the top. And you'll have to do that after the servitors are killed. So usually the best way is to just do the first damage phase up at the top, like stop the white mechanic, send down the scanner buff, someone grabs it, and then someone at the bottom sends up the operator buff just after it's been grabbed, and then someone at the top grabs operator, and then whoever grabs operator is just gonna keep it up top for literally the entire time. Like, they're not gonna have to transfer operator down. Operator needs to stay at the top area. It's the scanner buff that needs to, at that point, keep going up and down and up and down. Because there's going to be four bosses in total that do a white mechanic every single phase, so to speak. So it's gonna start on the top. You stop that guy, send scanner down. It happens at the bottom. You stop that guy, send scanner back up. Happens at the top. Send scanner back down. Happens at the bottom. Then you send scanner back up, and there's gonna be no more damage phase for quite a while. But you want scanner to end back up because it's gonna start back up the next time there's a damage phase. Okay, I know that's a lot to take in, but trust me, you will get used to it, and it really boils down to someone having scanner and calling out which boss to damage, and then just transferring it in the transfer station, and the other half of the team doing the same thing over and over and over again, right? But we have to talk about what the operator does. So again, at some point, you need to transfer that operator from the bottom to the top. Potentially, you can have someone starting at the bottom, get the operator buff, and then take the drop pod up to the top and then just stay at the top with the operator buff. That's a possibility as well. You can transfer them via the drop pod, kind of. But you're going to notice that every boss you kill drops a purple sphere, similar to the purple sphere that you went near to start this encounter. And anyone who goes over that sphere and kind of stands on it for a little bit is going to get a debuff. Aatrox 1 replication, and it's going to give a time counting down from 45 seconds. If this counts down to zero, you die. And then an Aatrox boss spawns at where you died and wipes your entire team. So you don't want to let it get to zero. And by the way, it will keep counting down even if you haven't picked it up. So you want to pick those up as soon as you kill that boss. But what do you do to it? Well, that's what the operator is going to do. Whoever has that buff needs to go up to the top, because you can only do this at the top. But then they need to follow the operator to one of these airlocks. The operator is able to shoot the red data pad next to the airlock. It opens it up. Then you, with that buff, and as you can see, you're going to be like glowing purple for everyone to see. You need to go into that airlock, and the operator shoots the literal glowing purple part, like actually basically shoots you with that glowing purple sphere above your head. That drops the purple sphere, and it drops it in the airlock. So basically, you're killing Aatrox, you're grabbing his soul, and you're shooting it out of the airlock, quite literally. Now that's pretty easy to do if you're at the top. Like, you just grab it after you kill the guy, run to whatever airlock the operator calls out, and then run in, get it shot off you, run back out, you're good to go. But again, it's also gonna happen at the bottom. So people at the bottom need to actually be rotating consistently to the top. Once you kill a boss at the bottom, someone needs to grab that soul and head into a drop pod and head up immediately. Once that person from the bottom gets to the top, then they're simply directed by the operator to which airlock door to go to, and then they simply get it shot off them. Maybe they're going to be around for another damage phase. They can help sort a guy at the top. And then as soon as that's done, they're likely going to head back down as quickly as possible via the drop pod. Now, some really important mechanics to know about with that replication debuff. So you can actually reset the timer if you shoot it off someone's head, but only the operator can shoot it off someone's head. So likely what's going to happen is you have someone coming up from the bottom and they're like, oh my gosh, I forgot to do it. I only have 5 seconds. As soon as they come out of that drop pod, the operator can shoot it off, and then they can simply pick it back up again, and the debuff starts again at 45 seconds. You have a lot more time to go and do the airlock thing. So you can reset it with the operator shooting it off, and then you can just pick it back up again. Technically, you can also get it shot off and someone else can pick it up if you don't want to do it. Another important thing to note is that two people can use the same airlock. Like, if the person from the bottom gets up to the top pretty quickly, or likely if they're coming up from the bottom damage phase and you've just finished with one at the top, you're gonna have two people with those buffs. So then you can open one airlock, they both go in there, the operator shoots the purple off both of them, and then they both just come off completely cleansed. But you do want to do the airlock thing pretty quickly because it will close after a certain amount of time being open, and potentially you can even get stuck in there and you'll die. Okay, so that is almost it for the mechanics of this encounter. To summarize one more time because it is so complicated, essentially, what you're going to do is slay out on adds until servitors spawn. When this happens, you need to kill the buffed enemies, scanner on top, and operator at the bottom, and people need to grab those buffs. Then when all the servitors are dead, it's gonna be a white mechanic at the top first. The scanner points out the glowing yellow one. Everyone goes to that guy, damages them as much as possible. Once that's done, the person with scanner uses the transfer station to send it down to the bottom. Someone at the bottom grabs it, and then someone who has operator puts operator in so it can go to the top and stay at the top for the rest of the encounter. Then there's gonna be another white mechanic at the top, do the same thing, damage the glowing guy, send it back down, another encounter at the bottom, damage the glowing guy, send it back up, and then it's gonna kind of stay at the top until the next big damage phase of that whole transferring situation. All the while you are killing these bosses, you're collecting their purple souls and jettisoning them out of the ship via the airlock doors, all controlled by the guy who has the operator buff. And this whole time, the bosses are gonna be shooting at you constantly, and we notice that there's pretty much all arc damage, and there's a lot of it. So I would recommend putting on the Risk Runner, which is gonna mitigate a ton of that incoming damage and really help you clear out adds pretty darn fast. Then probably running a sniper and the sword is your best strategy. The last thing we need to talk about for this encounter is the white mechanic. Once you've lowered the health down to that bar, you're going to notice all of the different enemies disappear from the bottom and they all go to the top. At this point, everyone needs to get to the top. If you're at the bottom, take a drop pod up to the top. You want everyone up here. Then the one guy with scanner is gonna have to call out which of all these different guys is glowing yellow, and everyone needs to go and damage that one guy. It should be noted that while a ton of bosses are up here, only ever four at a time are doing the white mechanic. So if you see two bosses and whoever has scanner is calling out, he's like, middle front, and there's kind of two in the middle front, and one's just standing around shooting at you, one's doing the white mechanic, it's obviously the guy with the white mechanic. But really importantly, you don't just have to stun them. You will actually have to do this entire bar of health in only four different stuns. You're gonna have one. Once you stun that guy, it goes to one more. Once you stun that guy, it goes to presumably two at a time. So you have to stun those last two guys really fast. The best approach that we found for this in order to do enough damage, this may change when you're higher level, but in order to do enough damage, simply follow the leader. Someone with scanner takes out their sword and just goes to the guy that's glowing. Everyone does a crap ton of damage. They quickly look around, find the next guy, get to that guy as quickly as possible. Everyone does a crap ton of damage. And usually after three, you can actually get this done. And sometimes the fourth guy, you just kill that guy and it will finally complete this encounter. And there you have it. That's how to beat Aatrox. All right, moving on from there, we do have a jumping puzzle and there's a chest that we found during this jumping puzzle. So I'm gonna show it to you guys. So as you're navigating through this area in space, eventually you're going to be on the right side of this kind of wall. You're gonna jump up and there's a big opening, kind of your first really big opening. Then head to the other side, drop down as you can see, and there is a brand new raid chest. These are very important because they're going to give raid mods. And remember, you can actually only equip those to any armor that you got within this raid, but it's an additional fifth mod slot. So you can have a raid mod on and a seasonal mod and potentially two, you know, reload mods and a discipline bonus as well. Now, I doubt you'll have the energy for that, but still keep that in mind. And some of these mods are very beneficial. So once you get them at that point, a lot of them are going to help quite a bit if you put them on. But moving on from there, you're going to continue through this jumping puzzle and you're going to get to this room here. Okay, so this encounter is a little bit interesting. There's going to be a big boss in the middle of this arena, but you actually won't need to damage him. You just have to do a bunch of mechanics 4 times in a row. So, with that in mind, you don't need stuff to damage the boss. Put on your Fallen Guillotine sword, put on shotguns, stuff that produces war mind cells, stuff that will let you kill a bunch of adds in this room, as well as those pretty big fallen captains with those void shields, and you will again have to take down overload champions as well, so make sure some people have things capable of stunning them. But yeah, you're just worried about ad clearing, and then the hardest thing you have to kill is those champions, so as long as you're set up for that, you should be good. Now, you have the 2 buffs that we've seen so far, Operator and Scanner. They are back, but there's actually a new one, Suppression. And all 3 are going to need to work together to accomplish these mechanics. So, as you start the encounter, bunch of adds everywhere. Essentially, 1 add with 1 of the buffs is gonna spawn off on the right, in the middle, and then off on the left. And it's kind of randomized where they spawn. But, for example, the guy with Scanner, as you can see, spawned off to the right. We went to the right, killed the guy, picked up Scanner. Scanner has been acquired. Once you see the guy with the red buff, Operator, kill that guy, someone picks it up, Operator is acquired. The other buff, Suppression, is going to be blue. So a guy has a blue symbol above his head, someone kills him, Suppression acquired. At this point, there needs to be a team for each one of these buffs. So basically, 2 people are on Team Suppression, 2 people are on Team Operator, and 2 people are on Team Scanner. There's a very good reason for that. I'll explain why in a sec. But all 3 buffs need to be performing specific actions. As you can see, when you have Scanner, your job is to figure out which of the different devices to put nuclear cores into. So you can very clearly see on the gameplay, there's 4 different devices here, 2 are glowing yellow. So I call out, you know, if they're both on the right side, I say right 1, right 2, or both right. If it's both of the ones closest to the boss, I think that was 2 for us, so you'd say L2, R2, right? It doesn't matter what you designate these as, but make sure everyone knows that designation and the scanner is going to look and call out which ones you need to utilize. Now, at this point, you actually need to get nuclear cores. That is the job of the operator. The operator, once they have their buff, and you see the text in the bottom left of your screen, several nuclear cores begin charging, then the operator can shoot the data pads that are glowing red near the correct nuclear core drop sites, essentially. So the operator is looking around, which one's glowing red? This one is. They shoot it, it becomes available for someone to pick up. They look for the other one, they shoot it, someone else picks up the other one. There's always going to be 2, kind of, unless you've screwed up, then there might be more. But once the operator shoots that data pad, again, someone is gonna need to go and collect it. Likely, whoever doesn't have a buff, they're a great candidate to do so. But if you have Scanner, for example, there's nothing stopping you from actually going and getting the nuclear core and depositing it, and you can see exactly where it goes. However, as you can see, when you pick up this nuclear core, you can't run and you can only single jump, and you start to get a debuff, a radiation debuff. When this gets to times 10, you'll instantly die. So you need to get to the deposit boxes as quickly as possible, or you can actually transfer to a teammate. If for whatever reason, it's a smaller room, so you should be able to make it, but if for whatever reason you can't make it, someone can actually come to you and interact with you and take your nuclear core. So you don't get to times 10 and then they start their own debuff, right? And then you'll slowly start to lose your radiation buff. You're gonna go down to times 0 again. However, at this point, if you take the nuclear core to the proper glowing device, you won't be able to put it in. That's because the suppressors have to do their job. What they have to do is stand under the correct spheres or balloons, I guess you could call these, and shoot the boss with their suppression buff. Now, importantly, there's 3, 1 in the middle, 1 off to the left, 1 to the right, and all 3 of these are gonna be glowing, so you go to one, let's say you go to the left one first, shoot the boss, then it'll stop glowing, you're done with that one, you go to the middle one, shoot the boss, it stops glowing, you go to the last right one, finish off the boss, and then once you've shot the boss from all 3 of the different like balloon locations and used up the glow on all 3 of them, As you can see, the boss is really gonna stun. A bunch of electricity will go all around him, and at that point, the boss is officially stunned, and then you can plant the nuclear cores in the correct devices, and there you go. And that's really all you need to do. Scanners find out which things to plant in. Operators let you actually pick up the nuclear cores by shooting the data pads, and suppressors go to all the different glowing balloons and shoot the bosses from there to stun the boss to let you plant those nuclear cores. You basically just do that same exact thing 4 times in a row and you are done. However, there is a bit of a caveat. After you complete a phase, one random person's buff, so it could be the scanner, could be the operator, could be the suppressor, is going to have a new debuff. As you can see, it says deactivated augment. That is why you are in teams of two, because what you need to do is go and put your deactivated augment in the transfer station, and then your partner picks it up and they have a good as new augment. When you have done this, you'll see you have an augment lockout, so you can't just pick it back up. You will need a teammate. So the scanner team, like I was on scanner, if we had the deactivated augment, I would put it in, my teammate would pick it up, and he would start doing my job. If he ever got it again, we'd switch again, but that's unlikely to happen twice on one guy. Regardless, you will have to be aware of that. And that's really, again, the only caveat. It's just doing that same plant of the two nuclear devices 4 times in a row. Once you've done that, as you can see, the floor is actually going to open up. You want to drop down here as quickly as possible and run towards the end of the hallway. If you get here fast enough, then it will complete the encounter. You'll get a nice little raid reward, and now we have the final encounter of the Deepstone Crypt against Tanix the Abomination. So, what do you do here? Well, all of those mechanics from the previous encounter, someone with scanner, someone with operator, and someone with suppression, those are going to come up again. All right, so scanner is again going to have to point out which devices to plant nuclear cores in. However, they're much more spread out. There are 2 in each third of the map. So you have kind of an orange side, there's 2 here. You have a bluish side, there's 2 here. And you have the spawn area, there's 2 here. So the scanner is gonna have to look around the entire map, probably just fly around really quick, get a look at which 2, only 2, will be glowing. Type in chat or just remember, say it out loud, you know, it's the left blue one and it's the right orange one. Or, you know, it's both in spawn, both in spawn. But you're gonna have to distinguish which ones are glowing. And just like last time, you have the possibility to get a deactivated augment. So that's why you need a partner. Like each augment has a group of 2, so you can quickly transfer scanner or operator or suppression between 2 people when it's defunct. But once you've called out the different places to plant, you're then going to have to survive for a bit. Eventually, as you can see, the boss will start doing something where he makes giant purple pillars come down from the sky. You want to avoid these because they will hurt you, damage you, and you want to get as close as possible to the boss or potentially further away if you're using a sniper rifle, and you need to damage his different thrusters. He has 4 thrusters, 2 in the front, 2 in the back. Probably want to damage the first 2 first. Each time you damage them enough, they're gonna explode and drop a nuclear core, as you can see. So make sure to not over damage. You don't want 3 nuclear cores, you only need, and you only want 2. So 2 people have to rush in and pick up those nuclear cores and try to make it to the called out devices by the scanner guy to plant them in. But we have some problems. You're going to notice right away that as you're trying to make it there, a giant purple sphere appears completely halting you. This is the job of the operator. So the operator buff this time lets you shoot those purple spheres in those little rotating orbs and destroy it, letting you continue your way to the device you need to plant the core in. You also really want to have 2 people really babysitting each core because it's a pretty long way often, so you will need to switch people almost always. And then of course you have the suppression team. Every time the boss will go to 1/3 of the map to start doing the purple rain stuff. And so at that point, once you've destroyed both of the thrusters and dropped the nuclear cores, the suppression team needs to use the different balloons. They're white this time. They look a little bit different, but there's going to be three different like tech balloons in the area near the boss, and they need to do the same thing. Stand under the glowing ones with the buff, shoot the boss on one till the glow's used up, go to the other one, do the same thing three times to stun the boss, and then you can actually plant the nuclear cores in the devices. So what that means is that the guy with operator is not really rushing in and grabbing a core. He needs to actually shoot the bubbles. And then the person with suppression, she's gonna need to actually suppress the boss by standing underneath the different balloons. So they're not running in either. It's the other people. The scanner guy can go and get one of these nuclear cores. And then the other two or whatever other random teammates you have, they can grab cores. Again though, the operator and the scanner need to stay out. They have important jobs to do. So you're going to plant the first two nuclear cores from, let's say, his front two thrusters. Then you keep going for a bit. The scanner is going to find the next two places to plant in. And then he's going to start doing the purple rain mechanic again. And you shoot the other two thrusters. So the back two thrusters, they drop two more nuclear cores. You grab those, get them all the way to where they need to go. And at that point, after four have been planted, he starts the damage phase. But it's not that simple, because you're going to see a massive glowing electric field around the boss, and also some things flying around that's important to know about. So, debris is going to be flying around the outside of this area. You want to avoid that. If it hits you, it can insta-kill you. So you kind of want to get inside of the electric field in order to damage the boss. But it's a very thin area inside, because as you can see from the background gameplay, there's kind of two circles. There's an outer circle, and that's where the debris is flying around. And then there's an inner circle, and that will damage and kill you. So it's that little, you know, green zone, that little zone between the inner circle and the outer circle that you need to stand in and do your damage phase. And what should you use for this damage phase? Well, you're only gonna get three cracks at it before the boss is enraged, so you need to do a lot of damage. Something that helped quite a bit is the fact that I was using a divinity, and as you can see, it makes a bubble appear kind of at the bottom of the boss, so everyone on my team can just absolutely go to town on that bubble and get constant crits the entire time. So we were using the first in, last out shotgun with Vorpal Weapon. That does a phenomenal amount of damage and anarchies. So stick them with the anarchy for that damage over time, and then go to town with shotguns. However, when challenge mode is gone, likely gonna be a bit easier, but shotguns are still a great idea because they're so good at taking down the adds. Because he's floating in the air, you can't really use swords on him, but swords are pretty fantastic against the adds. You could always go to town with sniper rifles as well, but just remember to utilize a bubble or a well for the highest damage possible. And if you are using a well, make sure that you're using the Luna Faction boots if you have them, because that is actually going to give you the extra range you need to utilize a shotgun like the first in, last out. If you don't have a loony well, it's not going to work out very well. Then you'll probably have to use snipers or something like that. All right, and that's really most of what you need to know for this encounter. It's just the same three buffs doing their specific jobs, then getting to a damage phase by planting four of the nuclear cores and doing as much damage as you can. If you do so and you get him to that first, or I should say last, chunk of his health, then he's going to do a final stand mechanic, and this is what it looks like. Basically, the boss will just start teleporting all around the map. The bad news is that if you've been using a shotgun like the first and last out to damage him so far, that's probably been great, but it won't be good for this final stand mechanic because he teleports too fast. You can't reasonably set up next to him. So you will need to be using something that can damage him from long range. So when it's getting really low health, potentially just switch to a sniper or utilize good grenade launchers to hit him at range, something that can damage, and then he's gonna teleport, look to the other side, and then you can keep damaging him from a distance. And in this final stand mechanic, you're really not going to be able to set up a proper well or bubble, like kind of bubble, but even then not really, because there's going to be that purple rain constantly falling down on you. So you just need to be mobile. You need to constantly move out of it and just keep damaging him from a distance. But once you've done enough damage, you're done. That is the final encounter of the Deepstone Crypt. But you're going to notice something very interesting. After you've killed the boss and got a reward, there's then a chest. And when you interact with this final chest, as you can see, it's a cache of the crypt. So what you can actually do is spend your spoils of conquest that you get for doing raids on armor or weapons that you already got in this raid. So if you got a shotgun like I did, and maybe it wasn't the best roll, you can use your spoils to get another shotgun and have another crack at that god roll. There's also crypt caches that cost a lot more spoils, but can give you other loot that you maybe didn't get in that run. So definitely that's something to spend your time doing. Guys, that is it for the video. I hope you enjoyed, found this informative, and if you did, please remember to help me out by simply rating and especially sharing this video. If you guys want to see more Destiny 2 content similar to this, don't be afraid to slap that subscribe button. If you want to get in touch with me and keep up to date with the latest channel activity, the best way is to follow me on Twitter at @RickKakis. That's linked in the description down below. Again, I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, have a good day.